everyone, and welcome to the webinar today on the transition scheduling plan public notice that went out a couple weeks ago. I have a few housekeeping announcements before we get started today. One is that you can access the slides that are going to be shown in today's event on www.fcc.gov/incentiveauctions/resources, and those are under the Notices and Guidance tab. A few other announcements and just general incentive auction related news. Last week, the task force and the Media Bureau released several public notices. One of them was to update contact information in LMS and on the FCC Form 177. So we remind you to go ahead and update your contact information if you have not done so recently. And also, we released a public notice seeking comment on updating the cost catalog, and the comments are due for that November 14th. So with that, I will turn it over to Gary Epstein, the chair of the Incentive Auction Task Force.
Thanks, Erin. Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us for today's webinar. Our subject is the staff's detailed transition scheduling plan proposal. The purpose of the plan is to determine the order and schedule for TV stations transitioning to new channel assignments following the incentive auction. But first, let me timestamp today's presentation. It is October 17th, 2006 at 1:04 p.m. Eastern Time. The incentive auction itself is well underway. Bidding in stage two of the reverse auction ended last week with a 37% reduction in broadcaster clearing costs. Bidding in stage two of the forward auction will begin on Wednesday. The Congressional and Commission mandate to implement a market-based solution to repurpose UHF spectrum on a voluntary basis is working as planned. Second, planning for the transition can't wait. We recognize the need for a balance between repurposing UHF spectrum as expeditiously as possible with the need for a transition that is flexible for broadcasters and minimizes disruption to viewers. That's what the post-auction transition is all about. In more than 4 years of implementing the incentive auction, we have found it works best when we make a specific, detailed proposal to obtain public interest. We did this both for auction design and for the incentive auction band plan. We've done the same thing here. The incentive auction task force, working with the Media Bureau, Wireless Bureau, and Office of Engineering and Technology, will present that proposal today. Our work to date has included multiple discussions with broadcast stations, engineers, tower crews, equipment manufacturers, wireless providers, trade associations, and others. The information you've already provided to us has been invaluable in shaping the plan we propose. Our goal is to forge a broad consensus among all industry stakeholders and one that is in the public interest. Finally, I want to stress that what you hear today, the post-auction transition scheduling plan, is one very important part of the overall post-auction transition. In coming weeks, you'll hear about the other post-auction issues, including broadcast construction permit process, broadcaster reimbursement and relocation reimbursement fund, the flow of funds to winning bidders, consumer education, and other outreach efforts. Today, we'll take a deep dive into the transition scheduling plan. Afterwards, we expect that you will comment on some of our assumptions, conclusions, and even the methodology. But time is short, and we urge you in your presentations and comments to provide specifics. It's important that you also analyze the effect of whatever you propose on the overall transition plan and on our collective ability to implement a successful post-auction transition. With that, I'll turn the podium over to Gene Cadu, Deputy Chair of the Incentive Auction Task Force.
Thank you, Gary, and welcome, everyone. The theme of this transition is coordination. Every station's move is in some way related to all other stations' moves, whether or not it's through interference, resource management, geography, or all of the above. This means that no individual station or group of stations can achieve the transition in a vacuum. All the stakeholders, the TV stations, the wireless carriers, suppliers, consultants, and the commission, must be in accord so that we're moving at the same pace in the same direction. Virtually all of the parties that we've heard from to date agree that close coordination will be essential and have urged that we put in place a schedule that can be used to guide their planning. While we don't know precise numbers or identities of the stations that will need to move to new channels until the auction concludes, our September 30th public notice sets forth a methodology for doing so once the final stage rule is met. Our aim is to be able to establish a detailed schedule of when the FCC expects specific stations to complete their transition by putting stations into different phases so that stations, tower crews, and equipment manufacturers can manage their planning, scheduling, and supply chains. The assumptions that we have made in the model have been based on comments received from a wide range of parties, so we're pretty confident that they are reasonable. But now is the time for you all to make sure we get it right in our model. Participation by interested stakeholders in the comment process is crucial. As Gary said a few minutes ago, we've often found ourselves navigating uncharted waters when developing the policies for the incentive auction. Offering specific proposals that engage stakeholders on the details of how best to balance the often competing public policy goals has proven time and time again to be the best way to build consensus and maintain momentum. That's why we put out a comprehensive and detailed proposal and are taking this extra step of presenting this webinar and taking your questions today. Now that we have put out our proposal, the time for generalized questions and concerns about methodology and assumptions is over. Instead, we urge parties to provide detailed comments and proposed solutions, including the ramification of any such changes on other parties and the timing and costs of the transition. In your comments, that will enable us to adjust the proposal as appropriate to assure efficient and timely transition. Finally, let me take one more moment before I introduce the main attraction to preemptively answer two questions. No, the data and results presented in the public notice and technical appendix, which you'll see again today, are not indicative of anyone's bids or bidding strategies in the auction. And the examples presented are for illustrative purposes only. As they say in Hollywood, any resemblance to actual auction participants is purely coincidental. And yes, as we advised in the September 30th public notice, the prohibited communications rule is very much in effect. Please make sure that your questions, comments, and any other filings are compliant with that rule, and we've provided information about that in the public notice. So we have a lot to cover today, so let me introduce Melissa Dunford, Director of Systems and Math Optimization for the Task Force, and Sasha Javid, Chief Data Officer and Legal Advisor for the Task Force, who will present how we constructed the proposal. We'll take a short break during Melissa and Sasha's presentation at about the 25-minute mark, and then another break before we go into a Q&A session at the end. Throughout the presentation, we invite you to email your questions to iatransition@fcc.gov. That's iatransition@fcc.gov. FCC staff will collect your questions that you send by email, and we will direct them to our panel of experts during the Q&A period. So with that, let me turn it over to Melissa and Sasha.
Welcome to the Transition Scheduling Plan webinar. The primary purpose of this webinar is to provide detailed information about the transition scheduling plan proposed in the public notice we released on Friday, September 30th. Specifically, this presentation focuses on the material covered in Appendix A of that public notice. Before we get going, I'm going to provide the usual disclaimers. Nothing herein is intended to supersede any provision of the Commission's rules or public notices. These slides should not be used as a substitute for reviewing the Commission's relevant orders, rules, and public notices regarding the incentive auction and the post-auction transition. The examples presented herein are for illustrative purposes only and are based on hypothetical channel assignments that do not rely upon or predict any auction results. Also as a reminder, the prohibited communications rule prohibits broadcasters and forward auction applicants from communicating any incentive auction applicants' bids or bidding strategies, including the results of bid processing by the auction system, to other parties covered by the relevant rules. A covered party may violate the prohibition when it communicates past or future bids or bidding strategies of any incentive auction applicant, regardless of the communicating party's intent. A communication that leaves little doubt about an incentive auction applicant's bids or bidding strategies may violate the rule, regardless of the lack of direct communication. Publicly available statements that disclose an auction applicant's bids or bidding strategies may violate the rule, including statements in oral or written comments. However, comments that address the advantages and/or disadvantages generally of aspects of the transition scheduling plan, for example, comments on technical interdependencies or resource constraints to be considered, would not violate the rule. One final administrative note before we get into the presentation. We will have a break at the conclusion of this presentation before the question and answer session begins. If you have questions related to this presentation or the Transition Scheduling Plan public notice, you may email those questions now and during the presentation to iatransition@fcc.gov. Please try to get your questions in before the end of the presentation. When submitting questions, participants should be mindful of the Commission's prohibited communications rule, as we just discussed. During this presentation, we will cover the following topics. First, we will provide an overview of the transition scheduling plan. Next, we will review the concepts of a dependency graph. It is dependencies between stations which creates the coordination problems for stations that need to transition. Then we will review the two tools that will be used to generate the transition scheduling plan. It is important to point out that we won't know the precise number or identity of stations that will move to new channels until the final stage rule of the incentive auction has been met and the final channel assignments have been made. What we present today is the methodology embodied in these two tools that will then be used to create the actual transition schedule. The first tool is the phase assignment tool, which will be used to assign transitioning stations to specific phases. The second tool is the phase scheduling tool, which will help the FCC to establish the end dates for each phase, which we call the phase completion dates. Finally, as I mentioned before, when the presentation is complete, we will have some time to answer your questions. I will be presenting the first section on the overview of the proposal. Then Sasha Javid, Chief Data Officer and Legal Advisor to the Incentive Auction Task Force, will present the remaining sections. Following the close of the incentive auction, many of the TV stations remaining in the air will be assigned to new channels. The stations that may be moved to a new channel include not only stations that are currently on channels in the new 600 MHz band, but also stations that are currently on channels in the post-auction TV band. Any station that will remain on air after the auction may need to move its channel based on the repacking done in the final channel assignments. The appendix to the PN laid out the staff's proposal for planning an efficient and orderly transition of these remaining stations. Under this proposal, we propose to use a phased approach. The proposal assigns stations to one of 10 transition phases with staggered completion dates. Overall, a phased transition schedule achieves several goals. First, it provides a clear schedule and early notice to broadcasters. Second, it limits disruption to broadcasters by protecting broadcasters from undue interference during the transition and by easing the need for coordination among broadcasters. Third, it prioritizes clearing the 600 MHz band by moving as many TV stations currently broadcasting in the new 600 MHz band as early in the transition as possible. It minimizes consumer disruption by limiting the number of times that over-the-air viewers will have to perform rescans to find the new channels. It prioritizes demands on limited resources. And finally, it facilitates the tracking of the progress of the transition by the FCC. There are several steps to generating the actual transition schedule. Here we present a flow diagram of the process we propose. The first step in the process is running the final channel assignment optimization software to generate the final channel assignments for all remaining TV stations as we described in Appendix E of the application procedures public notice released in October 2015. The final channel assignments will be determined once the final stage rule has been met. The final channel assignments are input to the phase assignment tool, which determines the order in which stations must transition to new channels. With hundreds of stations needing to move to new channels, there are millions of possible sequences. Therefore, the phase assignment tool will attempt to find the best possible sequence consistent with overarching transition goals. The output of this tool is an assignment of stations to phases. The phase assignments become input to the second tool, the phase scheduling tool, which takes the assignment of stations to phases and estimates the total time necessary for stations within a phase to complete their transition. The output from the phase scheduling tool is the estimated average time it will take to complete each phase. This will be used to guide the Bureau in establishing phase completion dates for each phase, which become the actual transition schedule. The incentive auction will officially end with the release of the auction closing and the channel reassignment public notice. This is when the clock starts ticking on the 39-month post-auction transition period. However, once the final stage rule of the incentive auction has been satisfied, no additional stages of the auction will be required. Therefore, while the forward auction bidders continue bidding in the forward auction clock phase and complete the forward auction assignment phase, the FCC will already have the information it needs to begin to finalize the details about the post-auction transition for broadcasters. Prior to the close of the auction, we intend to send each station that will remain on the air after the auction a confidential letter identifying the station's post-auction channel assignment, technical parameters, and its assigned transition phase. We propose to send these confidential letters because we recognize the importance of providing broadcasters with as much time as possible to prepare for the transition. The transition scheduling plan has the following key aspects. First, all stations that are required to transition will be assigned to a transition phase. All transition phases start at the release of the closing and reassignment PN and end with a testing period for all the stations in that phase. At the start of the testing period, stations in that phase can begin testing on their post-auction channel. This is the only time period in which stations are permitted to broadcast on their post-auction channel prior to the end of the phase. At the end of the testing period, stations in that phase must cease operations on their pre-auction channel and may begin broadcasting on their final channel. Here we present a graphical representation of a phase transition schedule under the proposed approach. The data represented in this graph is hypothetical, as the actual stations that need to transition are not yet known. The bars in the graph represent the length of each phase in terms of months. The gray segment of each bar, shown on the far left, represents a transition pre-planning period. As shown in the upper left-hand corner of the graph, this is the time in between when broadcasters receive their confidential letters and when the closing and reassignment public notice is released. We expect stations to take advantage of this additional time to ensure that they complete their construction permit applications in a timely manner and get a head start on completing other planning activities like zoning. The light blue segment of each bar represents construction permitting. Stations reassigned to new channels will have 3 months from the closing and reassignment public notice release date to file their construction permit applications proposing modified facilities to operate on their post-auction channel facility. The medium blue segment of each bar represents the time during which stations will be undertaking the planning and construction of their new facility. The dark blue segment of each bar represents the testing period for each phase. As indicated in the graph, the testing period for any phase starts on the day immediately following the completion of the prior phase. The one exception to this rule is Phase 1, whose testing phase will be set by the Commission at a time well before the completion of that phase. The red line at the end of each bar represents the phase completion date. At this date, stations assigned to the phase must cease operations on their pre-auction channel. Note that this is a hypothetical schedule, so it does not show calendar dates. But in the actual transition schedule, the dates will be included. So why have transition phases? An alternative approach would be to set just one date at the end of the 39-month window for all stations to transition. On this slide, we will discuss the reasons for a phased approach and the many advantages we believe it offers. First, industry has consistently commented that a phased transition is the best option and that the FCC is best positioned to decide phase assignments. Second, phases facilitate tracking of transition progress. Third, phases provide prioritization of the limited resources. That is, the limited resources can focus first on stations that are in early phases. Phases help alleviate the problems caused by dependencies. Sasha will talk a lot more about this issue in the coming slides. Phases give us more flexibility to clear spectrum in the 600 MHz band for wireless services faster. Phases help with international coordination efforts. So now that we've discussed an overview of the transition plan, I will turn the presentation over to Sasha Javid to get into the details.
Thank you, Melissa. Now that you have seen an overview of the transition plan, we are going to get into some of the specific details. First, we explain what a dependency graph is and why this matters when determining the transition phase assignments and schedule. So what exactly are dependencies? Stations do not create additional interference when they are all on their pre-auction channels or when they are all on their post-auction channels. This makes sense because when all stations are on their pre-auction channels, this is the current status quo. When all stations are on their post-auction channels, the pairwise constraints used in the final channel optimization ensures that no station will experience more than de minimis additional interference from any other station. But one station operating on its pre-auction channel can create significant additional interference with another station operating on its post-auction channel if these stations transition at different times. In the table, we show just such an example. If station A and station B have co-channel interference protections, they cannot both be on channel 25. Before station B can move to its post-auction channel, station A must move to its post-auction channel. Thus, we say that station B's move is dependent on station A's move. We can graphically represent these dependencies by making each station a node of the graph and use arrows to illustrate the direction of the dependencies. If multiple dependencies are connected, they create a daisy chain. In this example, station A must transition before station B, station B must transition before station C, and station C must transition before station D. This means that station D must wait for stations A, B, and C to all transition before it can transition. You will note that the orderly fashion of this chain fits well with the transition phases model. The dependency due to interference is removed by time partitioning the transitions of A, B, C, and D in that order into four non-overlapping time segments. Daisy chains can be very large. This illustrative daisy chain of 29 stations shown in blue on the map extends from central Florida all the way into Canada. If a set of dependencies do not have a starting or ending point, then they form a cycle. In this example, station A must transition before station B, station B must transition before station C, and station C must transition before station A. If stations A, B, and C do not transition at the same time, at least one station will experience additional interference. In this map, we show that cycles can also be very large. In the map, we present an illustrative cycle of 196 stations, which spans much of eastern North America, including stations in both the US and Canada. In this next map, we show the daisy chains interwoven with cycles and that they all can create a mess. These 796 stations are connected by dependencies, creating one long daisy chain, including many cycles. These interwoven daisy chains make a fully regional approach, as suggested by some commenters, much more difficult, particularly in the dense eastern seaboard. Arbitrarily creating regions, such as the Mid-Atlantic states and the Midwest states, would have many dependencies with neighboring regions that could result in significant interference for multiple months. So what are the challenges created by these dependencies? For each station and daisy chain to be able to test without causing additional unacceptable interference, the number of phases would have to be the same as the length of the chain. On the other hand, stations and cycles must be assigned to the same phase or else they will cause unacceptable interference. In order to have a reasonable number of phases and to facilitate coordination, a transition plan must address these long daisy chains and large cycles. We discuss the possible methods to address the problems created by these dependencies in the coming slides. One way to address large daisy chains and cycles is to group parts of the daisy chain and entire cycles into a single phase. Collapsing daisy chains and cycles into the same phase will require stations to coordinate testing and flash cut to the new channels together in order for the stations not to interfere. These are called linked station sets. Thus, to summarize, dependencies, that is, daisy chains and cycles, exist in the real world as a matter of physics and geography. On the other hand, linked station sets will be our regulatory construct as we group stations into phases to manage dependencies. In this example, we have a daisy chain that has 6 consecutive dependencies. Thus, station A must transition before station B, and station B must transition before station C, etc. Linked station sets can be used to shorten this daisy chain. In this example, we have collapsed the daisy chain into 4 consecutive dependencies by introducing 2 linked station sets. Now, station B and station C create 1 linked station set, and station D and station E create another linked station set. The result is that we now have shortened the daisy chain to just 4 dependencies. To accomplish this, station B and station C must coordinate their testing together and flash cut together, and station D and station E must coordinate their testing and flash cut together. One might ask, why didn't we not propose to simply collapse all daisy chains into a single phase by putting transitioning stations into 1 large linked station set, where all stations flash cut at the end of the 39-month transition period? Some may even think that having all stations transition at once is what happened during the DTV transition on February 29, 2009. But this analogy is incorrect because the February 2009 date was the deadline by which stations had to turn off their analog channels. But by this date, TV stations had already been broadcasting on the new digital channel for some period of time. Here, we do not have the luxury of allowing stations to operate on 2 different channels throughout the transition period because there simply are not enough channels available now to allow all stations to operate on 2 channels simultaneously. Thus, for many of the reasons Melissa mentioned, we rejected this option. Again, because stations requested a phase transition. Most stations realized that what worked in the DTV transition was simply not possible during this transition given the lack of available channels. 2, stations would need to coordinate with many more stations to test new equipment. 3, there would be no way to monitor progress of the transition. And 4, there would be no way to guide the limited resources to higher priority stations based on interference dependencies, and stations and third-party equipment vendors and tower companies, consultants, and others urged that we provide the schedule that would help them coordinate and manage the availability of resources throughout the transition. Linked station sets are one technique to manage the length of daisy chains created by dependencies, but these linked station sets do still require coordination between stations. Thus, we also looked at other techniques to ease the length and complexity of daisy chains and cycles. Temporarily increasing interference above the current protections of 0.5% additional pairwise interference will decrease the number of dependencies and therefore decrease the length and complexity of daisy chains and cycles. This increased interference will only occur when one station is on its pre-auction channel and another station is on its post-auction channel. Increased interference was used in order to facilitate transitions to new services. For example, in the DTV transition, 2% pairwise and 10% aggregate interference was permitted. As another example, the Commission permitted new wireless licensees in the 700 MHz band to cause temporary increases of up to 1.5% interference to broadcasters. FCC's staff analysis has shown that allowing some additional pairwise interference will not lead to significant additional aggregate interference. We share this analysis later in this presentation. While it is possible that some level of additional pairwise interference would break all dependencies, too aggressively relaxing interference protections could result in 100% interference to a particular station for many months during the transition. Similarly, trying to decrease interference by reducing power could result in one station being required to essentially go dark for many months. Thus, our proposal attempts to strike a balance between decreasing dependencies by allowing some small amount of additional temporary pairwise interference versus forcing stations to be subject to high amounts of additional interference for many months. Assigning a station to a temporary channel before it transitions to its post-auction channel could also be used to break up complicated cycles and excessively long daisy chains. In this example, by putting two stations, station C and G, onto temporary channels during the transition breaks a set of 9 station width dependencies into just 5 phases with no linked station sets. The trade-off is that station C and station G will have to move twice, first onto a temporary channel, shown in red, and then onto their final channel, shown in blue. At this time, we do not propose to use temporary channels because of the increased inconvenience and cost, but we'll consider comment on this proposal. If we were to use temporary channels, we could limit temporary channels to be close to the station's post-auction channel to reduce the inconvenience on stations and the purchase and installation costs of temporary equipment. In particular, limiting temporary channels to those channels next to, or at least very close to, a station's post-auction channel would save tower work processing time, provided the main antenna can serve both the temporary channel and the post-auction channel. We also point out that stations designated to move to temporary channels would have the costs associated with both moves that would be eligible for reimbursement. Now that we've provided an overview of how dependencies between stations complicate the transition and of the techniques that we propose to use in order to manage these dependencies, we will discuss the phase assignment tool. But before we move on, this might be a good time to take a short break. Let's plan to reconvene in 10 minutes. However, if you already have some questions that you want to ask, feel free to email us at iatransition@fcc.gov. As I mentioned before the break, now that we've provided an overview of how dependencies between stations complicate the transition and of the techniques we propose to use in order to manage these dependencies, we will discuss the phase assignment tool. The FCC will use the phase assignment tool to assign stations to phases. These phase assignments are designed to manage dependencies. So how exactly does the phase assignment tool assign stations to transition phases? The phase assignment tool uses both constraints and goals to determine which stations are assigned to which phases. Constraints are rules that assignments must satisfy. Goals or objectives choose among assignments that satisfy the constraints. Commercially available optimization software is used to create the assignments with respect to these goals and constraints. The next few slides describe the specific constraints and objectives proposed. And at the end of this section, we'll have a few results slides which show the impact of using this tool. We propose to use the following constraints in our phase assignment tool. All constraints must be satisfied. 1. Every transitioning station will be assigned to one transition phase. There will be no more than 10 transition phases. As we discussed earlier, there is a trade-off between the number of transition phases and the number of linked station sets. While increasing the number of phases could decrease the number of linked station sets in each phase, a large number of phases may undercut other transition goals, such as transitioning stations within the same DMA or region at the same time, and minimizing the need for multiple channel rescans by viewers. We also believe that limiting the number of phases will facilitate monitoring of the transition process. We believe that limiting the number of transition phases to 10 strikes a reasonable balance between these goals. As a side note, Canadian stations not impeding the transition of U.S. stations may be permitted to continue to operate beyond Phase 10 based on the rules established in Canada. 3. No U.S. station will be assigned a temporary channel. Although we do not propose to assign stations to temporary channels, we invite comment on whether we should use temporary channels. At this time, we do not intend to use temporary channels because of the increased inconvenience and cost, as we mentioned before. 4. No station falling into the complicated category for purposes of the phase scheduling tool can be assigned to phase 1. The goal of this constraint is to allow adequate time to transition the most challenging stations and to prevent an early phase completion date to be delayed due to the most time-consuming stations. Our definition of a complicated station is the same as was used in the final channel optimization. 5. All stations within a DMA will be assigned to no more than 2 different transition phases. The proposed DMA constraint regionalizes the transition to the extent possible without creating significant coordination problems. For example, taking a station's DMA into account clusters stations in a particular geographic area into the same 1 or 2 transition phases. Doing this will make resource allocation more efficient. For instance, tower crews would be able to focus on multiple stations in a specific area during those phases. Additionally, and perhaps more importantly, the constraint will benefit consumers by limiting the number of rescans the consumer will have to complete because of the transition. While this constraint potentially increases the number and/or size of linked station sets within a transition phase, on balance, we believe that the benefits to consumers and stations outweighs the burden caused by this constraint. 6. The difference in the number of stations in the largest transition phase and the smallest transition phase will be no more than 30 stations. This constraint will attempt to make the number of assigned stations in each of the phases somewhat equal, which in turn will help manage limited resources by ensuring that they can spread more evenly across transition phases. 7. No phase can have more than 125 linked stations. Because we propose to use linked station sets to deal with dependencies created by collapsed daisy chains and cycles, and because these linked station sets will still require coordination between all stations in this linked station set, we propose a constraint to limit the number of linked stations within any phase. This constraint will limit the effect of those dependencies and, to the extent coordination is needed, facilitate a manageable transition process for broadcasters. Based on staff analysis, we believe the proposed 125 station limit strikes a balance between minimizing dependencies and other goals. 8. A station cannot cause more than 2% new interference to another station during the transition. Staff's analysis indicates that allowing temporary, limited increases in pairwise interference would reduce the number and complexity of dependencies without resulting in significant aggregate interference increases. Doing so is also likely to promote other potential goals, such as prioritizing the clearing of the 600 MHz band and reducing the number of channel rescans by TV viewers. Although allowing a higher level of temporary interference, up to 5%, for example, would further reduce dependencies, our proposal to allow no more than 2% represents a compromise between causing undue interference and limiting dependencies. As with our proposal, we invite comments on the costs and benefits of this proposal. 9. No stations in Canada will be assigned a transition before the third transition phase, and no Canadian stations will be assigned to a temporary channel. Due to dependencies between domestic and Canadian stations, a joint transition plan with Canada is necessary and is being developed by the FCC and ISED, the Canadian regulator. In keeping with our informal discussions with ISED Canada to date, stations in Canada have generally been assigned to later transition phases under our proposal. This constraint will promote efficient use of cross-border resources and respect the minimum notification periods to Canadian TV stations established in ISED's 600 MHz decision. Now that we've summarized the 9 constraints that we'll be using the phase assignment tool, we're going to talk about some of the objectives that the phase assignment tool uses. Respecting the constraints, the phase assignment tool then attempts to find the optimal phase assignments that achieves the designated set of goals or objectives. The phase assignment tool prioritizes the proposed objectives in the sequence listed below. Subsequent objectives would be constrained by prior objectives. Objective number 1. Assign U.S. stations whose pre-auction channels are in the 600 MHz band to earlier phases in order to clear the 600 MHz band as quickly as possible, while simultaneously assigning Canadian stations and U.S. stations whose pre-auction channel is in the remaining television bands, i.e., U.S. TV band stations to later phases where possible. This objective promotes a number of goals. One, it would help clear the 600 MHz band first in order to open up wireless licensees the opportunity to offer new innovative services. And two, it would also prevent Canadian and U.S. stations from competing for limited resources and provide Canada with the needed time for its transition. Objective number two, minimize the sum over all DMAs of the number of times TV viewers in a DMA must rescan. This objective benefits consumers by minimizing the number of rescans necessary by viewers in a market and creates regionalized clusters that will make resource allocation more efficient. As in constraint number five proposed above, the use of DMAs attempts to provide similar benefits to those that would flow from a purely regional geographic approach. Objective number three, minimize the total number of link stations. This proposed objective is different than constraint number seven proposed above in that it would minimize the total number of link stations throughout all phases of the transition, as opposed to within a particular phase. This objective seeks to provide as many stations as possible with the ability to test their equipment on their post-auction channel while simultaneously broadcasting on the pre-auction channel without the need to coordinate. Objective four, minimize the difference between the number of stations in the largest transition phase and the smallest transition phase. Like constraint number six proposed above, by minimizing this difference, this objective attempts to reduce to below 30 the maximum difference between the number of stations in each phase. We believe that evening out the number of stations assigned to each transition phase will help manage limited resources by ensuring that they can be spread more evenly across transition phases. Before we get to some analysis of the results generated by the phase assignment tool, we should probably touch on some of the international assumptions used in this proposal. FCC and ISED Canada are coordinating closely on transition timing, consistent with the agency's intent to jointly repack TV stations in both countries. Therefore, this proposal assumes a joint repack with Canada. As we indicated in our discussion of constraints and objectives, Canadian stations are generally assigned to later stages. And third, we also note that Canadian stations not impeding the transition of U.S. stations may be permitted to continue to operate beyond the 10th phase based on the rules established in Canada. Though, in the following results, we assume that all Canadian stations will have completed their transition by Phase 10. Consistent with our coordination with Mexico, this proposal assumes that Mexican stations will have transitioned to their new channels before the phase completion date of Phase 1. We are now going to look at some analysis of the results or phase assignments generated by the phase assignment tool. Using the constraints and goals described above, the two bar graphs on this slide show the distribution of stations assigned across 10 phases using two different clearing targets, 114 MHz and 84 MHz. Both scenarios show that U.S. stations currently in the wireless band, shown in dark blue, will have generally completed their transition by Phase 8. Both scenarios also show that our load balancing constraint, constraint number 6, as well as objective number 4, ensures relatively equally sized phases, which allows better management of resources by ensuring a more even distribution of the draw on limited resources. Additionally, very few Canadian stations, shown in red, are assigned to early transition phases. Those that do transition early must do so in order to allow U.S. stations or other Canadian stations to transition. Finally, we note that these are hypothetical scenarios to two different clearing targets, but the phase assignment tool can be applied to any auction outcome. A deeper analysis of the assignments generated by the phase assignment tool reveals several interesting facts. First, however, we note that the 114 MHz scenario, the assignments coming out of the final channel optimization shows that 1393 or 1,393 U.S. stations and Canadian stations are required to change channels. Of those 1,393 stations, 1,201 are U.S. stations. Similarly, in the 84 MHz scenario, the assignment coming out of the final channel optimization shows that 1,274 U.S. and Canadian stations are required to change channels. Of these 1,274 stations, 1,122 are U.S. stations. With respect to the assignments generated by the phase assignment tool to transition all stations within 10 phases, we note the following key points. First, the median size of the link station sets is just 3 stations. Second, the largest link station set is only about 100 stations, well below the constraint of 125 stations. Remember, link station sets are sets of stations within the same phase that have dependencies requiring coordination before any station in the set can transition. This is why the phase assignment tool attempts to avoid creating large link station sets. Finally, and number three, more than 50% of the DMAs will require only one rescan. In this next slide, our analysis shows that when temporary pairwise interference is allowed to increase to 2%, the temporary aggregate interference levels do not increase much. At 114 MHz, the number of stations subject to more than 2% temporary aggregate interference is only 15 stations, and the maximum temporary aggregate interference is only about 3.2%. At 84 MHz, the number of stations subject to more than 2% temporary aggregate interference is only about 14 stations, and the maximum temporary aggregate interference is only 2.96%. In the next two series of slides, we show how these phase assignments look in our 114 MHz scenario when plotted on a map. The first set of maps shows which stations are transitioning in each phase and the number of rescans remaining for each DMA. In the next set of maps, we once again show all 10 phases, but this time we show progress in clearing the new 600 MHz band in each PEA. Before we look in detail at each of these maps, please note that these slides are available for download on the Incentive Auction website. And at the end of these slides, we also include these same maps for the 84 MHz clearing target. The maps in this first set have color-coded the DMAs based on how many transition phases will be required for each DMA. Green, at the start of the transition, indicates that the DMA has no stations required to transition. Green in subsequent phases means that all stations within the DMA will have completed their transition by the end of the phase. Yellow, at the start of the transition, means that only one transition phase is required for all stations within the DMA. Yellow in subsequent phases means that at least some stations within the DMA have completed their transition by the end of the phase, but there remains other stations which will have to complete their transition in a second later phase. Red, at the start of a transition, means that two transition phases are required for all stations within the DMA. Red, in subsequent phases, means that no stations within the DMA will have completed their transition by the end of the phase, i.e., two transition phases are still required. This is what the map looks like at the start of the transition. As we just described, DMAs that are shaded in red require two transition phases. Those DMAs shaded in yellow require one transition phase. Finally, those DMAs shaded in green already have their transition phase complete because no stations will need to transition in this scenario. We emphasize that these maps are for illustrative purposes only based on the hypothetical list of channel reassignments and therefore should not be viewed as any guide as to which stations and what areas will transition in any particular order or phase. Here we show stations transitioning during phase 1 in this hypothetical scenario. Any DMA which has stations transitioning during this phase have their contours highlighted. Also, USTV band stations are shown in light blue, US 600 MHz stations are shown in dark blue, and Canadian stations are shown in violet. However, because we impose the constraint that Canadian stations cannot be assigned to a phase before phase 3, we do not see any Canadian stations in this phase 1. Here we show stations transitioning during phase 2. In phase 2, we have the first complicated stations transitioning. The definition of what it means to be a complicated station will be discussed in more detail in our slides describing the phase scheduling tool. Next, we show the stations transitioning during phase 3. In this phase, we have the first Canadian stations transitioning, shown in violet. Next, we have the stations transitioning during phase 4. As a reminder, since this is new, the stations that are in DMAs that are colored green are transitioning during phase 4, and at the end of phase 4, those DMAs will have completed their transition. Likewise, stations in yellow DMAs are transitioning during phase 4. However, the yellow DMAs mean that after phase 4 concludes, other stations in that DMA still need to complete their transition in a subsequent phase in order to have that DMA's transition be complete. Finally, if a DMA is shown in red, no station has completed its transition. Remember that under our proposal, each DMA will have no more than two phases. Next, we show the stations transitioning during phase 5. And again, we show stations transitioning in phase 6. By this phase, most EMAs have turned green. And again, we show stations transitioning during phase 7. Here, we show stations transitioning during phase 8. And again, we now show stations transitioning during phase 9. In phase 9, the stations that are transitioning are primarily US TV band stations and Canadian stations. Finally, we show the stations that are transitioning during phase 10. At the end of this phase, all stations will have completed their transition, as indicated by the fact that all DMAs are now green. The maps in the second set have color-coded PEAs based on the average impairment across all 9 blocks. The map shows the average impairment across all 9 blocks at the end of each transition phase. In actuality, each block would have its own level of impairment, but this average gives us the best sense of just how quickly the PEA is clearing overall. Now we'll go through the next slides showing the level of impairment in each of the next 10 phases. So this is what the impairment level looks like across 9 blocks in phase 1. And again, what the average level of impairment looks like in phase 2. Again, what the average impairment level looks like in phase 3. And now we show the average level of impairment in phase 4. By phase 5, we have made substantial progress in clearing the 600 MHz band. Phase 6, now a good majority of the 600 band is cleared throughout the nation. And again in phase 7. Now, by phase 8, most of the remaining impairments in the 114 MHz scenario are coming from Canadian stations along the border who have not yet transitioned, and Mexican stations which are not clearing channels below channel 37. But for the most part, the US 600 MHz band is now clear. This is what the average impairment looks like at the end of phase 9. And finally, this is what the impairments look like at the end of phase 10. All stations have transitioned both in the US and Canada, and the impairments that remain are along the southern border created by Mexican impairments. We've now concluded our presentation of the constraints, objectives, and results of the proposed phase assignment tool, as well as shown how the representative assignments generated by that tool look on the map. We now turn to the phase scheduling tool, which will help the FCC determine the transition schedule based on phase assignments made by the assignment tool. The phase scheduling tool is an open source discrete event simulation software, which will help the FCC establish the duration, testing period, and end date for each phase of a given assignment coming out of the phase assignment tool. The phase scheduling tool estimates the total time necessary for stations within a phase to perform the tasks required to complete the transition process. As we illustrate below, tasks are divided into two sequential stages. One, the pre-construction stage, and two, the construction stage. But first, there are a few things to note. One, all work within a stage must be complete for the station to move into the next stage. Two, tasks within a stage can be processed simultaneously. Three, resources that are limited and needed by many stations can delay the entire task completion. They are treated separately. Arrows outlined in bold are the processes involving limited resources. Four, all tasks that are not impacted by how many other stations are performing similar tasks are grouped together, and a single estimate provides the total time needed to complete all of the tasks. How we determine the duration for each task will be covered in detail in the coming slides. The times are station-specific based on certain characteristics of each station. However, we do not cover in this presentation every input used in this model for these tasks. Complete details are included in the appendix, and we encourage everyone to review that document. Administration planning includes all tasks during the pre-construction stage that must be completed before construction can begin, and they include zoning, administration, legal, possible structural tower improvements, equipment modifications, etc. Resources required in the administration and planning tasks that are not treated separately because they're in sufficient supply include auxiliary antenna manufacturing and transmitter manufacturing, transmission line manufacturing, and RF component installation. All resources necessary to complete these tasks are assumed to be available when needed. Time estimates for the admin planning tasks classify stations into three categories: complicated stations, DTV stations, and Class A stations. And we note that all times are conservatively estimated. Construction-related work includes the time to complete all construction work and the associated management and coordination of those activities. Construction-related work includes installing the transmitter components, combiners, RF mask filters, and the transmission line to the tower base, installing liquid cooling systems, AC power, and connection to remote control equipment and input signal connections, and if required, performing any tower modifications and any final testing of the system. Similar to the admin planning tasks, time estimates for the construction-related work classify stations into three categories: complicated stations, DTV stations, and Class A stations. And again, all times are conservatively estimated. And similar to the admin planning tasks, all resources in the construction-related work necessary to complete these tasks are assumed to be available when needed. The FCC has determined that antenna manufacturing and tower crews are in such limited supply that these resources must be treated separately. In the phase scheduling tool, if a station needs a constrained resource and it is unavailable, the station must wait in a queue until the required resource is available. The model assumes that stations assigned to earlier phases will begin their activities before stations assigned to later phases. This is a key assumption that requires cooperation by stations and vendors. The model assigns an ordering to all stations. Stations in earlier phases receive a lower order number than stations in a later phase, and the order is random for stations in the same phase. Each ordering of stations, called the simulation order, provides a single estimate of the time to complete each transition phase. By repeating the simulation multiple times, with stations in the same phase entering the system in a new random simulation order, the phase scheduling tool produces a range of completion times for each phase. The FCC intends to use this range in determining appropriate phase deadlines, given the composition of the individual stations in each phase. As we mentioned, primary antenna manufacturing capacity is limited. The time assigned in the model for the manufacture and delivery for the antenna is based on the type of antenna needed, for example, whether it is a full power station or whether the antenna is directional, and whether the manufacturer can begin to manufacture the antenna when ordered. Because industry can only fulfill a limited number of orders per month, stations wait in a queue until manufacturing capacity is available. The queue is prioritized by phase assignments and then by station order within a phase. In the diagram presented on this slide, we show just how the model prioritizes the fulfillment of antenna orders. First, we see that station 1, which falls in phase 1, was the first in the queue in the model and has actually already left the queue and received its antenna. Station 3 and station 4, also in phase 1, were ordered next in the queue and have also already left the queue and are having their antennas manufactured. In this smallest illustration, manufacturing has a production capacity equal to 2. That means that the manufacturing can build 2 antennas in parallel at any given time. Station 2 and Station 5, the last two stations in Phase 1, were placed in the model second to last and last, respectively, in the queue for stations in Phase 1. Due to antenna manufacturing capacity constraints, these two stations have to wait for Station 4 and Station 3 to have their antennas manufactured before they can leave the queue. Stations 6, 7, and 8 are assigned to Phase 2, and so the model does not let them leave the queue until stations in Phase 1 have left the queue. Station 9 was assigned to Phase 3 and will not leave the queue until all stations in Phase 1 and Phase 2 have left the queue. Finally, in the appendix, we note that we do not count the delivery of auxiliary antennas against the antenna manufacturing capacity constraint. After feedback from industry, we are confident that the manufacture of auxiliaries will not be a problem for antenna manufacturers, even if all stations order an auxiliary antenna. As has been well documented in the many filings with the Commission on transition-related issues, tower crews are limited in supply. Therefore, the phase scheduling tool assumes that there are a limited number of qualified and equipped crews. Stations request a crew based on the site location and complexity. For example, crews able to work on the most difficult sites. As a second example, crews able to work on average difficulty U.S. sites. And finally, crews able to work on Canadian sites. If all crews of the required type are busy on other sites, stations enter queues similar to the antenna procurement. The time to complete the tower work is based on whether the tower crew is available when needed, and if not, the station waits until there is a tower crew available, and the time for a tower crew to complete all tasks once begun. These estimates are station-specific. For example, as detailed in the appendix, a station on a taller tower, for example, above 1,000 feet, or having a top-mounted antenna, will have longer time estimate to complete the task. The appendix provides the data needed to estimate the time required for a tower crew to complete their work. We highlight two assumptions here. One, in the model presented, we assume that at 75% of the stations that are transitioning will order an auxiliary antenna. Although, as previously noted, we do not expect this demand to invoke manufacturing capacity concerns, we do assume that any station receiving an auxiliary antenna will need an additional 5 business days to install this auxiliary. Two, the estimated time required to complete work on a tower is reduced or discounted if more than one station on the tower is transitioning in the same phase. The phase scheduling tool assumes that antenna installations will be performed by a single tower crew at the same time for all stations located on a given tower that are assigned to the same phase. The total time estimated will be the time required for the most difficult station on that tower, plus 10% for the second station, an additional 5% for each additional station, up to an additional 30%. In the next two slides, we present the output coming out of the phase scheduling tool for the two scenarios. First, the 114 scenario. The information will help the FCC determine the actual transition schedule by providing a reasonable estimate of the time required for each phase, given the number of stations transitioning and the expected availability of resources. In this scenario, the average number of weeks to complete phase 10, as determined by the phase scheduling tool, is approximately 149 weeks. This is a function of both the number and type of stations transitioning in each phase and the available resources. We should also note that, as stated in the appendix, this tool ensures that every phase will have at least 4 weeks for testing. Here we present the output coming out of the phase scheduling tool for the 84 MHz scenario. As we noted, this information will help the FCC determine the actual transition schedule. In this scenario, the average number of weeks to complete phase 10, as determined by the phase scheduling tool, is approximately 160 weeks. You will note that although slightly fewer stations have to transition in this 84 MHz scenario versus the 114 MHz scenario, the total estimated time to reach the end of phase 10 is actually slightly longer. As stated in the previous slide, this is a function of the number and types of stations that transition in each phase and the available resources at any given time. So with that, this slide concludes our presentation on the phase scheduling tool and also our presentation overall. We hope that this presentation has been informative about how these tools fit together and how the FCC proposes to use them to create an orderly transition process. We will now take a short break before resuming with the Q&A session. If you have any questions related to this presentation or the Transition Scheduling Plan public notice, you may email those questions now to iatransition@fcc.gov.
All right, we're back, and we've received quite a few questions, and we'll try to cover as many as possible in the next few minutes. If we don't get to your questions, feel free to reach back, and we'll try to answer them after the webinar. Joining Melissa, secondly, we received one or two reimbursement questions involving specific equipment, that whether it will or will not be reimbursable. This webinar really doesn't cover reimbursement. We're going to be having lots of separate outreach on that topic, so I think we'll save those questions until the next time. Joining, let me introduce our panel. Melissa Dunford, who you heard on the slide presentation, and Sasha Javid are here at the table with me. And then joining them is Barbara Kreisman, who is the chief of the Media Bureau's video division. I think most of you probably know Barbara. So let me start with questions. These are in no particular order. I've tried to group as best I can sort of the technical transition plan scheduling questions, and then the sort of the questions that are more Media Bureau oriented, but they're really in no particular order. So the first question, I think, Sasha, is probably for you. Why doesn't the phase scheduling tool account for weather and other seasonality types of issues?
Thank you. Basically, the answer to that is, one, we don't actually know when time zero begins because we don't know when the auction will begin. So to have planned that a certain phase is going to end at some winter period or some weather-related event would be too early to make such an assumption. But two, the model basically provides a phase completion date, and any of the work that needs to take place to complete the transition can happen any time throughout that phase. So if you know that your phase is ending in the winter months, you should be able to plan accordingly so that you get the work done if you think that weather might be an issue. And the last reason I would point out is we did talk quite a bit to particularly tower crews and industry about just how much of an impact weather might have. And the short answer is, even tower crews in Canada have told us that they work, 12 months a year. And the major factor of when they might not be able to work is wind, and that's variable. So to say a priori that you're not going to be allowed to do any tower work for the months of December through February is probably too conservative.
And as we have done in the past during other periods of construction, during the DTV transition, we will work with broadcasters to work around unforeseen conditions. We can use SDAs, we can use temporary channels, we can use a multicast solution.
Thank you. Melissa, do we have access to all of the assumptions that you incorporated into the model?
So the short answer is yes. In Appendix A, we have provided all the details necessary for interested parties to be able to replicate the methodology. We've also been asked about having access to the tools themselves, and the answer to that is we are not planning on releasing these tools, as we didn't release the software for the clearing target optimization or the final channel optimization. However, we did provide full descriptions of the methodologies, and specifically about these tools, the phase assignment tool uses optimization software, and it uses commercial optimization software. So any commercial optimization software package can be used to implement the objectives that we outlined in this proposal for the phase assignment tool. The phase scheduling tool is a simulation tool, and we use open source discrete event simulation software that there are many out there, and you can use any particular one and get the similar results as our simulation tool. So as far as the software is all available out there, the inputs have been described in the appendix as well as the methodology. And then finally, no, I think that's all I'm going to say.
Sasha, would the phase scheduling tool direct resources, such as tower crews and manufacturing resources, towards certain stations or regions at a given time? Would you restrict work in areas or stations not in a particular phase? How would that affect regular maintenance or emergency repairs?
Yeah, I mean, I think the short answer to that is we're not in particular directing a certain tower crew or a certain resource to a certain station. We don't claim to have that authority. What we're saying is we're putting out a schedule that shows across transition phases which stations have to transition by a certain phase, and we hope then industry will coalesce around that schedule so that, you know, let's say, for example, equipment vendors deciding which antennas to manufacture first, they'll look at the schedule and realize that certain stations have a higher, should have a higher priority because their station needs to transition in an earlier phase. So the short answer is we're not mandating any particular crew needs to go to any certain tower. All we're saying is that by certain dates, stations need to transition, and hopefully then industry can coordinate and coalesce around that plan.
We have, I just want to mention, we have actually done some outreach with manufacturers, and they have told us informally that they would take a look at our plan and try to coordinate it and facilitate it. And we hope that same kind of cooperation will exist in the industry.
So Barbara, are stations, if they don't like or want to challenge their phase assignment or their phase completion date or testing period, as we're going to set it forth in the closing and reassignment PN, can they challenge that?
Well, I will refer you to a wonderful public notice that was released on December 30th, 2016, and it talks about the plan and it asks for comment. And you'll see in paragraph 26 this very issue is discussed. And basically, right now, we would use our normal tools. In other words, if you don't like your phase assignment, you could file a recon or request for waiver. But the public notice actually asked if you have an alternative suggestion. I would ask that you not file any of those things, that you look at the plan and devote your resources into your phase, and if for some reason there's a problem, we will work with you. You know, we are vested. We are your partners in this. It's not you versus us. We're your partners in getting this transition done, getting it done expeditiously, getting it done efficiently, so that wonderful equipment can be implemented by broadcasters and the band can be reorganized.
So, Barth, I think that this next question really is almost sort of the flip side of that, but I think we've probably already answered it. What if a station wants to complete their transition early, i.e. prior to their phase completion date?
Well, during your phase transition, during your phase, you can complete it. You have to stick to your phase as far as when you're going to turn on a new channel. If you want to turn on your new channel during the phase, you can do that, but we would actually prefer that you all do it at the end of the phase, and that would be good for consumers because it would be one rescan.
Melissa, I think this one's probably for you. Objective number one, which I think was clearing the 600 megahertz band, seems to add undue weight to clearing that band quickly. Since the move of the television stations is only going to last 39 months, wouldn't minimizing the number of stations to be moved be a more practical and sensible objective?
It is sensible. So actually, we do that in the final channel assignments. The primary objective in the final channel assignment optimization is to maximize the number of stations that stay on their current channel. So once we have the final channel assignments that has maximized those, then we move into these tools that then schedule the transition. And the objective primary here is to clear out the band for the wireless providers as soon as possible.
Thank you. Sasha, I think this is just a technical question. The testing period is the period when both pre-auction and post-auction channels are broadcasted. Is that correct?
That's correct. So during your testing period, you can operate both on your pre-auction channel and your post-auction channel. The exception to that would be linked station sets. With linked station sets, we will tell you who your linked station set neighbors are, but you would need to coordinate with them when you do your testing. And that's one of the reasons we have an objective about limiting the size of those linked station sets. So you would have to do some coordination of testing with the stations that we've designated as being your linked station set partners.
We've gotten a number of questions about whether a station has to go off the air during testing. As Sasha pointed out, if you're not linked, you have a lot of flexibility. Even now, when stations test, they will often schedule it in the middle of the night. You do have to coordinate if you are a link station. If you have an auxiliary, that's one way to certainly aid this transition. Kevin Harding of the video, senior engineer in the video division, has indicated that he's been receiving a number of auxiliary applications and he is quickly granting them. So that's something to think about. And if you already happen to have an auxiliary, that's one alternative you can use while you're going from one station to the other and one channel to the other, and also during the test period. We can also try to use other creative methods to make sure everybody stays on the air. But there is some coordination that's going to be involved, and if you have an auxiliary facility, this will facilitate that.
Sasha, I think a lot of these questions have to do with sort of moving between phases. Question here is, if a tower crew will be working at my site in phase three, but I'm not scheduled to move until phase 10, it seems inefficient to have to bring the crew back. Can I switch phases?
Well, I first point out that the definition of a phase is that it begins with the issuance of the channel assignment PN. So what that schedule tells you is what date you need to be off your pre-auction channel. The work that takes place before that time can be scheduled in conjunction with potentially station neighbors. What we'd ask is that when vendors and people take that into account, they consider the impact that it might have on other stations who might be assigned to earlier phases. So from a perspective of the actual construction work, you can get it done whenever during your phase, but the trade-off is that you might be taking away resources from another station that might have to go in an earlier phase. The other thing I'd point out is you can't actually test until your phase testing period begins. So if you're in phase 10, yes, your construction work could happen well before that, before phase 10 testing period begins, but the testing itself can't happen until on the new channel until you've reached your testing period. So that would be another reason why you might want to delay your construction work until potentially later in the phase.
Melissa, many public stations are licensed to universities or state entities. Oftentimes, procurement rules and contracting periods may take months for legal review, engaging a vendor, justifying sole source vendors, etc. State procurement rules may prohibit us from working with certain vendors. What sort of contingencies might you consider when our place in the queue comes up but we can't get paperwork processed?
So let me clarify a little bit of the timeline between the phase scheduling tool and when stations are actually going to start doing the work to transition. The timing is that the phase scheduling tool is run after the final channel assignments are done and before the closing PN comes out. So the phase scheduling tool is simply a simulation tool. It helps us, it guides us in our decisions about when to set these phase completion dates. It is not, the schedule does not include, oh, this station has to use this tower crew or it's going to take exactly this time for them to get their paperwork done. It's an estimate that we use to inform our decision about setting the completion dates. When the closing PN and channel reassignment PN comes out, you will see the completion dates for each phase. And at that point is when you know what your date is and you have the whole time from the closing PN until that completion date to make your transition. So what I would say is that there is a lot of time for this paperwork to get done because all phases start when the closing and channel reassignment PN is issued. So you have from that date till your completion date to transition.
And I would just add that when that closing PN and channel reassignment public notice comes out, it will be a public document. So it will not just be the stations who are moving and having channels reassigned, but the public. So vendors will be able to see it as well as equipment manufacturers, tower crews, and everyone, so that we are counting on that as helping the industry as a whole coordinate. Sasha, the use of a temporary antenna is likely to be required to meet FCC transition deadlines. How will use of temporary antennas be taken into account with regard to the number of times a viewer must rescan?
So the short answer to that is, you know, we leave it up to the station whether he's going to use an auxiliary antenna. If he then decides to use an auxiliary antenna and then potentially do his final antenna transition, perhaps after the phase at some point later, and operate on his future channel for some period of time on his auxiliary, if he then has to do a mandate, do a rescan at that point when his final antenna work is done, that's really on the station. We don't want to be, as the government, saying how, you know, forcing stations to have more, or DMAs or viewers to have to do more rescans than two. That's why we have that constraint. We say, look, for all stations within the DMA, they're going to have two times in which they're going to have to do rescans. If a station decides then to use an auxiliary and then do his final final rescan at some later point, because his auxiliary doesn't reach the entire audience or whatnot, that's on that station, and he's going to have to reach out to his broadcasters at that point. Okay. I'm sorry, his viewers at that point.
Thanks. This questioner also says that 10 phases equates to basically a two-month window between phases. How is a two-month extension for a complicated station determined to be reasonable? What's the basis for this determination?
Yeah. You know, basically what the constraint actually says is that we don't allow what Widelity called a complicated station to fall into phase one. So the trade-off or the benefit of that constraint is that those complicated stations actually will not have to transition generally until after year two or sometime during year two. So whereas phase one usually ends sometime after, you know, roughly after a year, you basically have a whole bunch of additional months up to maybe another year before stations in phase two have to transition. And that's because some of those complicated stations are going to have some, you know, we recognize that there'll be certain issues that challenge those stations in the transition. So we wanted to give them some additional time, which is why you see in the phase scheduling outputs that phase two is often timed quite a bit longer after stage one finishes.
Thanks. Sasha, this questioner says that he did not see a sometimes lengthy FAA approval process included in your analysis. Was that included?
Yes, we did include it. We didn't view it as a resource-constrained issue, but it certainly was included in the admin and planning task, and we do recognize that it is an issue that needs to be addressed.
Another one for you, Sasha. The public notice seemed to imply that the FCC will be assigning stations not just to channels and power levels, but will also be assigning them to antenna structures. Is this correct?
Short answer to that is no. We're not telling stations about, you know, which tower crews to use, what structures. In fact, we're not expecting stations to change structures. They don't have to do that. So the short answer to that is no.
Okay. Melissa, give Sasha a break for a second. Can a station request to be repacked to the top of the new UHF TV band so that it can subsequently sell its spectrum to a wireless carrier so that its spectrum can be converted to flex use?
No. There's no special request for where to be assigned in the repacking. It's a nationwide repack, and so the optimization software considers all stations at once.
Okay. Sasha, in an example that you gave during the presentation, Station A moved off of channel 25. Why can't Station B just move from 42 to channel 20 instead?
It's a good question, and you know, my answer is going to kind of piggyback off what Melissa said, which is there's a preliminary step, which is the final channel optimization, which happens before the two tools are used. And the goal of that, of course, as Melissa said, is to maximize channel stays, i.e. have as many stations as possible stay on the original channels. But once that final channel assignment is done, the assignments that each station gets is then fixed. So short of us mandating temporary moves, i.e. one station has to move to some other channel for some period of time, you have to deal with these daisy chain / cycle issues. And as we propose, as of right now, we're not suggesting to use temporary channels, although if people feel that that could help with the transition, feel free to file comments stating so.
Okay. Melissa, have channel sharing arrangements been factored into phases? For example, if a station entered into a channel sharing arrangement with a station that has to move?
So if a station is part of a channel sharing agreement and they are the sharee, meaning they are going to go off air, then our rules apply where they have six months to get off their pre-auction channel from the time that they get paid. And if they're the sharer station is transitioning to a new channel, then they're going to have to transition with their sharer station.
Another question for you, Melissa, was in the phase size distribution charts and maps, there is an entry for U.S. 600 megahertz band as compared to U.S. band. Is this capturing the fact that wireless 600 megahertz licenses may turn on during that transition process on a particular spectrum band but may have to move during phases of the transition? If not, what does it represent?
Yeah, so the label U.S. 600 megahertz band means those TV stations that are transitioning that whose pre-auction channel is in the 600 megahertz band. So they are currently operating in what will become the 600 megahertz band, but they are going to transition to a station lower in the UHF band. And though the label that says US band means those TV stations that are currently operating in what will continue to be the television band after the transition.
One more question for Sasha. For stations with multiple stations to transition post-auction, will the number of stations assigned to the same phase be considered? For example, could a broadcaster have all of its stations assigned to the same phase? Are any resource constraints applied to distribute a broadcaster's phase assignments over multiple phases?
Good question. The short answer to that is we do not have any explicit constraint which limits in either direction, i.e., all stations that a broadcaster owns have to go in the same phase, or no more than X number of stations within a broadcast group can transition within the same phase. So there are trade-offs to creating such a constraint. There could be more linked station sets. There could be more cycles created as a result of that. It may take away flexibility for clearing the 600 band. But if that's something that people wanted to consider, you know, we obviously welcome comments along those lines. But the short answer is we don't have any such explicit constraint in the model currently.
Okay. Here's a question. Perhaps I'll just answer, give you guys a break. If a broadcaster's supply comments limit the number of transmitters or antennas it can receive in a given time period by allocation, how will these be accounted for? Can the FCC modify supplier delivery contracts to ensure needed deliveries? I think the quick answer to that is that as we've said before, the entire industry will see the schedule when the channel reassignment and closing PN is released to know kind of when each station is assigned and what the schedule for that assignment is. And that's why we're doing phases, is so that there will be a schedule and it will be an orderly process. We don't currently have any plan to try to modify people's third-party contracts, but obviously we'd be interested in comments about what else we can do to make that schedule work well. So, Barbara, we've been ignoring you for a few minutes. in regard to transition timing, what is the process and timing required to cease broadcasting for stations that have opted to relinquish spectrum?
Well, it's basically those stations aren't really part of the transition. They're going away. And so they basically get 3 months after they get their money. So it depends when they get paid.
Okay. We talked a little bit about the confidential letters that will go out after we reach the final stage rule and before that closing PN. Will all stations receive one, regardless of whether they're getting a new channel assignment?
Yes, all stations are going to receive a confidential letter that's going to basically say where they're going to be post-transition. And the purpose of these letters is to give stations a head start when it comes to planning. These letters, I want to point out to you, with respect to these letters especially, last Thursday we issued a public notice that warns people to please keep your contact information updated. The PN goes on to explain what contact information we're going to use. So I need you to pay attention to and to look for it. I think it's DA number 16-1173, last Thursday.
Okay. While we're on the subject of confidential letters, there's a question here about whether confidential letters sent to stations remaining on the air can be shared with their counsel and or consulting engineers without violating the anti-collusion rules. There was a section, as I mentioned, in the public notice that was released on September 30th about the prohibited communications rules. Basically, the bottom line is that stations can talk to vendors and even other broadcasters, but may not talk about bids or bidding strategies. And they must make sure that when they do that, that they ask whoever it is they're talking to not to serve as a conduit to other broadcasters who are bidding in the auction. We are also going to be thinking about ways that we can relax that rule once the final stage rule has been released, and we'll welcome your comment on that topic. Here's a commenter that wants to clarify the channel to construction permit process, Barbara. He says each station that has to change their channel will be assigned a new channel number by the FCC. We will then get with our engineers to work out the technical details for using that channel in our DMA and then file for a CP. He then assumes that he'll have 90 days from the time that the station receives a channel assignment to get the engineering done and file for the CP. Is that correct?
Chad, you have it exactly right. And now I'm going to do a little promo, and that is at the same time you're going to have to come in with estimate of costs on the Form 399. But we're not going to talk about that today, but it's a promo for an upcoming webinar at some point in time that will be announced.
Another question, Barbara. How is a station on a tower that can't support two or more antennas supposed to transition under this scheme? How can a station test new equipment and maintain and remain on its old channel?
Oh, I think that sort of goes into the same idea as the testing question. One way is to use an auxiliary facility. We have STAs at our disposal. We have other creative solutions that you guys come up with. We have a multicast solution. So I think that we're going to have to be somewhat creative in some of these transitions, but I think as we did during the DTV transition, we're going to be able to work it out if we work together and we work cooperatively.
This question is the same as the one that you just answered. Has any provision been made, Barbara, for stations to overlap service between old and new channels to provide nightlight service, as was done in the DTV conversion? Might it be possible, for instance, for one or two stations in a DMA to stay on the air for a couple of weeks without causing interference?
You know, this is not the same thing as the DTV transition. That was everyone moving to a different platform, consumers having to get new TVs. No, there's no provision for a nightlight service, and in fact, I think that would actually be contrary to the plan. And this is to emphasize, the thing is the phased plan. That's going to be our guiding instructions, our guiding how we're going to put this thing together. And since I know there are a number of broadcasters and representatives out there, there's a lot of coordination that's going to be done in the industry. And it's coordination that would be done for stations on a given tower, stations in a particular area, the kind of coordination that goes in all the time, and the kind of coordination that I know is well underway. Sasha actually informally consulted with a number of engineers, and I got to sit in on some of those calls, and we were really impressed with the level of planning that's already underway. It's just that this is another step in that plan. You're going to have to plan how all the stations involved in an agreement are going to be able to continue broadcasting. It may be temporary arrangements, multicast arrangements, but part of that plan has to be compliance with and respect of the overall plan.
Here's a question about a station, Barbara, that if a station initially indicated that its antenna is broadband but has since learned that its antenna is not broadband, can it amend its filing to let us know that if it gets a new channel, it will need a new antenna?
I think that what the question here refers to the old Form 381. No, you can't amend it, but don't worry about it. You're going to have an opportunity to file the equipment you have, list the equipment you have on the Form 399. Again, promo for an upcoming webinar. And at that point, you're going to accurately reflect what you have so that we're going to be able to see what you need to buy and what are the reasonable costs associated with those purchases. So don't worry about it.
Okay. One more question for you. How does the FCC envision changing the frequencies of transmitters, mask filters, combiners, and antennas without extensive outage impacts on consumers?
Well, first of all, as I consulted with Kevin Harding on this question, not everybody has to change everything. That's the first thing. And secondly of all, again, it's sort of the standard answer. Auxiliary facilities can help with this. STAs can help with this. Cooperative agreements where someone's using another facility temporarily can help with this.
Great. I think that's all the questions that I have in my pile. Let me ask the staff whether we've received anything more while we've been talking.
Can I clarify one thing?
Sure.
So I just want to make sure it's clear that when we publish the transition schedule plan, what that includes is the stations, what they're the stations that will be transitioning, what phase they're assigned to, if they're part of a link station set, and you'll know the stations that are part of that link station set, and you will know the completion date for that phase, for each phase. It does not include the station needs to use this tower crew at this time or anything that we would have simulated in our tool that was purely part of our simulation tool. So it's clearly up to the stations to decide what tower crew they're going to use, when they're going to engage that tower crew. What Sasha was explaining in the presentation about the phase scheduling tool, it's a tool for us to help estimate, to have an accurate estimate of how long we should allow for each phase. So to determine that, we simulate the transition, but it's a simulation tool, and it's by no means meant to dictate anything about what crews are used by what stations.
I'm glad you did that, because I found the question that this pertained to. And you anticipated it. So I think with that, the webinar will be available online on the FCC.gov website, as will the presentation. As I said, some of the questions that pertain to reimbursement and other topics we'll cover later, we'll get back to. If you had a question and I didn't correctly ask it or you had something else in mind, feel free to contact us. But thank you very much for joining us today, and I think we can adjourn.